welcome to MoneyPuzzle.in. I'm Lisa and you're watching My Friend Money. For those of you who are not familiar with what this series is about, it's really not to do with savings or investing or even financial planning. My Friend Money is really conversations with people about their money journey and their relationship with money. Our guest today is as versatile in how he leads his life as he is as an actor. His journey began way back in 2007 with theatre, moving on to ad films, Bollywood, and then web series, of course. You may know him as Dilbagh Singh from the most popular Netflix series, Sacred Games. We know him as Jaypreet Singh. Hi, Jaypreet. Thank you for joining us today.
Thanks, Lisa. Thanks for having me over.
So Jaypreet, you've done a whole pile of ads and you've done a lot of movies and series, etc. But we know that your journey really didn't begin as an actor and this came about later in life. So where did your journey begin as a professional? What did you set out to do?
Well, I completed my hotel management diploma in 98. Thereafter, I started as a bartender with TGIF.
Wow.
In May 1990. Yeah. So that's where it started for me.
Yeah.
So we were a bunch of guys from the same college, same hostel, same batch.
Yeah.
Who started our stint together. And then after about 2.5 years, I moved to learning and development. Mm-hmm. Having been trained by the international American trainers and being identified as a new store opener and in-store trainer.
Right.
So somewhere kind of found my bearing and did a very short stint with an upcoming call center for a while.
Yes.
Then the internal calling was always towards training. So when my very dear friend had joined a training organization, he pulled me in. So that's how it began kind of coaching me and I got into it full time. And then thereafter we started. And then from there to the acting world, to setting up my own organization, here I am.
I think the early 2000s were all about TGIF and call centers. So you were right in the middle of, all the excitement at that time.
Yeah.
So as you were saying, you were in corporate training and then you branched out on your own, right? And
yeah.
Relatively early, a lot of people wouldn't have done it at that stage possibly. So what was the, was it a push? Was it a pull? What was it?
Well, more of a pull, really, Lisa, because even when I was in organization, I was actively training people. I was learning, growing, pursuing my education, and I thought I could help the organizations best from outside.
Right.
And the desire to be an entrepreneur, being on my own, was always there because my antecedents are such. My father's a businessman. My mother's a businesswoman. My brother, though younger to me, was always a businessman. So kind of looking back towards my anchors,
mm-hmm.
found it relatively easy to make that decision. Sometimes when you come from a service class, you don't know whether it's going to work for you or not. But when you have kind of an anchor, a role model, some sort of an idea of what business looks like, then the choice becomes easy for you. And coupled with my skills, I knew I could do it.
Yeah. Where did this whole idea of acting come about? Did you really chance upon it? Or was it an active pursuit somewhere, you followed in life?
Well, it's interesting because in 2007, when I took a call to be on my own, so that was the time I thought, I'll do something in Punjabi theater. And I called up a friend of mine whose mother's a very known Punjabi actor and she features many films. But that didn't kind of come about.
Right.
She had another friend who was associated as an actor with a very famous director in Delhi called Faisal Al-Kazi.
Okay.
And so through him, I got an opportunity to be at Faisal's house. And then I read that script. And Faisal asked me, are you available these days? So I said, sir, I mean, it depends if I've made the cut. And he said that, yeah, you've made the cut. So it was serendipity kinds that, I chanced upon through a contact, one of the best directors available in Delhi. And the journey kind of began from there. So one play a year, two plays a year, but the journey continued.
So this was really your pursuit of your craft, which you felt that you have a leaning towards, a talent towards.
I didn't know really. All I knew is that I wanted to act, but I didn't know whether I have the talent or had the talent. I kind of grew into it. So the more opportunities I got, the more I became surer that this was it, and I'm okay. At least as a stage actor, I was okay. So that's where the confidence grew. Yeah.
And at what point did it move from being something you enjoy doing, a hobby you're pursuing perhaps, to something that is, a larger part of your overall being, and even to an extent, you know, something which is remunerative and something that you're looking forward to earning from?
Well, that's also very interesting because, many of the casting directors actually moved from Delhi to Bombay, and a couple of them I knew.
Right.
Maybe they'd seen my plays, they kind of spoke with me. And another couple of friends from the same Ruchika Theatre group recommended me to a couple of other people as well.
Right.
So all of a sudden I got a couple of calls, and then first advertisement came along. And that was Nestle. I remember going to Bombay and shooting and coming back. And my wife very proudly putting it on Facebook and saying, Jaypreet.
Yeah, sure. She should.
Is on screen. But it was more of a chance and connections and some kind people always recommending me. So that's how the journey began.
And this was how long ago? Sorry to button, but how long ago?
This was about 5-6 years ago.
Okay.
And then from there, as casting directors know you and there's a face on the screen, they inquire with each other as to who the person is.
Right.
Then the contact kind of, travels from one to the other and you start getting audition calls. So the audition process began from there, and all of a sudden a movie came along, and then very recently, a couple of years ago, Sacred Games, the web series came along, another series came along. So my identity in terms of being a corporate trainer also diversified, and had a parallel identity along with it, which is what I began enjoying. And of course, there is remuneration. There's a process of getting into it. But it is remunerative, so
So I think when we were talking last time, you also mentioned how you are also doing some counseling on the lines of being a psychologist, right? So you have these three very distinct identities: corporate training, acting, counseling. How would you describe this emotionally for yourself? Like, is it about taking risks, or is it about just pursuing your passion?
Well, in a way, you've answered the question. It is about pursuing your passion and taking that risk, because pursuing your passion in India today is taking a risk.
Yeah.
So it comes at a cost, but emotionally, it's very, very gratifying, Lisa, because I'm very, very happy to say all that I do it with a lot of intent and passion. And I'd like to believe that I'm somewhere, if not excellent, and somewhere in a position where I look back and say, okay, am I okay with my skills, whatever they are?
Yeah.
Counseling also gratifies my emotional need of working one-on-one in a social sector, in a private space, because there's nothing like watching people kind of cope with their problems and find the resources within to tackle them.
Right.
Acting is pure fun. This is where I'm at my creative best.
Yeah.
And the idea of picking up a script and playing a role and then coming back to being a Jaypreet.
Right.
And then all of a sudden being in the Vanity Van and being called, saying Sir Shota again, being that person, and playing being myself again.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden coming back to being in the social sector, in my private room where clients come, these days more over Zoom calls.
Yeah.
But the fact is it gratifying? Definitely yes.
You know, being an entrepreneur sometimes can also be very fluid, right? I mean, all of this is competitive. There is this whole thing we have to, we all have to earn a living, whatever we do. And you are, you're a family man, you've got a daughter, you are obviously thinking about how to keep your family secure. Do you get nervous at times thinking that on the sustainability of your various kind of ventures?
Oh, yes, of course. I mean, all the time.
Okay.
Yeah, all the time. So sometimes I think if I have money to last for the next 3 to 4 months, I feel elated and financially secure.
Yeah.
And if I don't have projects coming and it's only about a month left, so that's when the agitation begins to grow and I feel anxious. Of course.
how do you manage the financial security of it? I mean, are you a big saver, or are you just, because these are projects, they come and sometimes something will be more remunerative, sometimes not so much. So do you get insecure? How do you manage that aspect?
Well, I am a saver. And one thing that I've learned is to dissociate myself with the business. So, and the understanding kind of came slowly that I'm not my business, and the business doing high and low is not a reflection of who I am as a person. So business right. will have its highs and lows.
Yeah.
So over the last few years, whenever the organization did well, I saved more. When not, then I kind of tightened my belt, kind of prepared myself for bad times to come if there were. So that's how it is. And that's the equation with money. I'm not money, the organization's money. And so when we are doing well, the idea is to save as much as possible. And also, what's very important in consulting business or in a counseling-like profession is that you constantly study and grow. And so having that investment in yourself almost all the time,
right.
it, being in that continual recurring mode to invest in yourself, whether these are educational qualifications, whether these are certifications, whether it's supervision that we receive in terms of a counselor or as an OD person, the idea is to constantly be invested in yourself. And that's where the growth is. So a part of the money I have to understand always kind of needs to go back into investing in me and my education, because that's all the assets that we have.
That's a very interesting thing, because I think when you're working in a corporate, that doesn't come so naturally. You know, the idea that one has to invest in oneself. Even when you are by yourself doing your own thing, I think that's an idea that one has to, because you can't think of it as indulgence. It's really an investment, like you put it. But sometimes what happens when you're, you know, just doing a course or doing something, you start thinking that, you know, am I indulging myself too much? So you have to make that distinction and say that, no, you know, this is an investment, and there is use for it in future, which can kind of help.
Oh, yes, definitely. Yeah. Definitely. Even people in organizations, Lisa.
Do you miss the security, the job security of being in a corporate, the fact that you have, things like medical insurance and your provident fund all taken care of in that CTC, and your bank account, you know, clings every month that the money has come in? You don't have to worry about it. What more projects do you have to do, etc.? You don't have any of that. You just, you know, it's more regular. Do you ever miss that?
Well, yes and no, both. Yes and no, both. But largely, no. It's because now I've gotten into a habit of knowing what's most important. For example, I didn't know earlier that term insurance was important, especially being an entrepreneur and being the only breadwinner in the family for the last few years.
Yeah.
Didn't realize that term insurance was so important. And so somebody taught that, and saying, Jaypreet, if something happens to you, what would your family be like then?
Right.
And I said, oh, okay, yeah. I mean, you know, how much would that term insurance be then for me? And then calculating, okay, this is how much I earn, then you multiply it by an X number.
Yeah.
That's the term insurance. And then later realizing, no, Mediclaim's important, but yeah. does it have a critical illness rider in it?
Yeah.
I mean, these thoughts didn't come necessarily organically. I mean, they were forced in by people who did that. And luckily I've got friends around.
Yeah.
And there's an exchange of ideas. And then they tell me, and saying, Mediclaim liya?
Uh-huh.
Saying, yeah, Mediclaim liya. Kitne ka liya? I said, okay, this is the Mediclaim. Yeah. So we learn.
Yeah.
We learn from our friends. And many of my friends are self-employed.
Yeah.
And so that's how the learning takes place. For example, mutual funds, right?
Yeah.
Didn't know anything about shares.
Yeah.
So the classical investment tool, as we pick up when we are on our own, is I'm saying LIC le lo yaar. Then there's some friend somewhere, he comes along and says, you know, I sell my LICs, but you want to buy this? I'm saying, you know, it doesn't cost much, 1,000-2,000 rupees. And then you get married, then you say, okay, I must save more. And then somewhere organically, the whole idea of mutual funds and putting your money in the market beyond that PF and beyond that LIC comes along. So you kind of get attuned to the idea and saying what's more fixed, like a fixed provident fund or a fixed deposit, what's important, and you'll never get returns from there. It's like a Mediclaim and a term insurance, you know, but So where are you putting your money from where you're likely to get more returns? And are you looking towards market? So it's kind of a natural organic growth, Lisa, for all of us. The journey has been pretty much the same for me.
Do you relate to any of your childhood memories of money and what maybe you thought of it? And has that changed over a period of time?
Well, yes and no, both. So yes, because you know, the persistent message in the family when I was growing up was money is important.
Right.
And yet we saw some struggle for money. It was constant because we were uprooted from a place and then we went to the other place and then uprooted from there. It was kind of a migrant population. So yes, the realization that money is important was always there. But what to do with money when you have it? Yeah. There was no role modeling.
Yeah.
You see? So a lot of what I figured out was on my own, being in this place, Gurgaon, and trying to figure out on my own. Wow. So that was important. And also, a lot of people who I've seen make money and then pursuing their artistic passions are the people who made their money or at least have found some sort of financial stability and security being in their corporate job. So either at least they made their money there or at least they built a house.
Yeah.
They kind of come together and say, okay, there's X money and now I can risk it. But the journey to me has been very, very different.
Yes.
I found my calling and being a rebel, wanting to be on my own. And then being on my own and doing all of it is a very different journey.
Yeah, without that safety net.
Yeah, without that safety net. So that's a very different journey, but very rich and very gratifying as well. In some sense, I'm also very proud in saying, see, I did when I wanted to do it and kind of have made it to this place. Yeah.
Is it hard to prioritize like what you should do or not? How do you manage that? You feel bad sometimes, you give up certain projects or you feel, you know, it's like juggling things.
Well, it's only happened a couple of times.
Okay.
It's only happened a couple of times because I didn't know how the film industry works. So I was working with this very big banner and I realized this very big star. And I didn't realize that, you know, the dates get moved around for them and by them. And I had a corporate assignment here. So I checked with the production house and saying, okay, what are the dates that you want me there? They said that, okay, sir, we want you here this and these days. Okay. Just a couple of days. And of course, they moved the dates around saying, nahi sir, ab shooting nahi ho rahi hai, wo do hafte baad ho rahi hai. I said, no, but I've got my corporate assignment here. What do I tell my clients? So they came back to me and said, you know, what do we tell the actor? What do we tell the actor? That, you know, some actor who we got from Gurgaon is now backing out.
Yeah.
And then the realization that the paradigms are very different.
It's not really your priority, it's their priority as well, you know, that matters.
Yes. No, I'm not the priority. So my professionalism about my dates, my commitment, and I'm a professional. So this takes a back seat and the production houses and the actor, you know, the big stars' dates, they become...
What did you do? I mean, which of the two did you give up and which one did you continue with?
Well, not like I had a choice. I mean, I signed up for the film, they would have sued me. Of course, I carried on.
There's that angle as well, right? There's a legal obligation as well.
Yeah, there's a legal obligation. So I kind of worked around my dates with the corporate. And the problems with this production has just continued thereafter. For the next 1 year, we had problems one after the other. And the project kind of got delayed. There were weather issues. We went abroad to shoot. And all kind of problems came along. But then what I learned was... not a resentment of sorts, but what I learned was that these areas, these paradigms are completely different. The rules for one are very different from the rules for other. Professionalism in one means very different to what professionalism means in the other. Yeah.
You know, working in this industry of acting and films and even ad shoots and the series that you're doing, the web series, etc. Do you get carried away sometimes by all the glamour and, you know, the show? Do you feel like, you want to get there as well? Does it evoke any kind of such emotions?
Well, the desire to be there and desire to act better and to get better roles is very different from desire for glamour. So that's very different. And I definitely won the first one, the former. But the glamour has not attracted me because I haven't seen glamour at all. Yeah. In fact, it's been a very humbling experience, Lisa. So I did my first advertisement, one of the advertisements with Saif Ali Khan for Asian Paints. And it was surprising to see that the moment the shot would get over and the director would say, cut, the man would immediately wear his glasses, go back to the monitor and see if the scenes come out well. And that was an experience for me, watching such a big star, being so worried about whether the shots come out well or not. In subsequent experiences, I mean, big stars, I mean, from Shah Rukh Khan to Anushka Sharma to Pankaj Tripathi to Nawazuddin Siddiqui, I mean, I found it consistent, absolutely consistent. And so what was the message that I picked up was, you know, you're as good as your last performance. What was said and what I had learned, I was watching it in action. These stars equally and so worried about whether the shots come out okay, because they know how serious it is. And them wanting to give their best and then wanting to go back and sleep in peace. That is something that I saw, and not glamour.
We don't really see the behind the scenes kind of effort and hard work that goes into putting up that good show. Yeah,
of course, there's a lot.
So Jaipreet, one last thing. So, you know, through this conversation, what I can sense is that you've got a very a good foundation money-wise, and you've sort of, you know, ticked the right boxes, and at the same time, you continue to pursue what gives you pleasure and satisfaction as a professional. When we talk about our money relationship, right? I like to think of people as having, you know, either a positive relationship or a negative relationship, because one can have either or be indifferent. Would you categorize yourself as having a positive or a negative or, you know, an indifferent relationship with money?
Definitely positive. But the caveat is work hard for it.
Yes.
Always work hard for it. There's no easy money coming.
Yeah, there's no easy money coming. Great. Thank you so much, Jaipreet, for joining us today. And we wish you all the best for your various endeavors and hope to see you a lot more now on the web screen as well, and on the big screen, whatever that means after the pandemic. But, thanks so much for joining us here today.
Thanks so much, Lisa. Thanks so much for having me.